Welcome everyone to the 2023 Oklahoma Learning Innovation Summit. I am here with, Dr. Wooldridge and Dr. Jones, who are here to present Upskilling 2.0 Action Learning in the Workforce. Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tracy. So welcome to our presentation on best practices in workforce strategic partnerships, you know, workforce 2.0, if you will. Just to give a quick background about this presentation, the deans of the College of Business and Technology at NSU had a vision for quite some time on being more workforce friendly. And so they've pioneered a way for NSU to accomplish this. Last year, they brought Tena and me into the mix, and we have learned so much doing these classes and talking to businesses about how we can help them with their workforce development needs. And so we want to share what we've learned with you.
So a couple of the things that we want to talk about for the goal of this session are, what are some practical tools that we can use to teach workforce students? Who are they? What is going to make us better and more successful in these types of classes? And then what are some of the administrative considerations, of which there can be numerous, to help aid in facilitating a workforce class?
So first things first, what is workforce? Workforce is not just teaching the students, because we do that, obviously, but also building a partnership with a business. You know, we try to reach out to businesses that are concerned with retention and developing the talent that they have. You know, there's so much competition out there in recruiting employees. These businesses really want to impart to their employees that they are investing in them, which obviously helps with retention. This workforce initiative helps expand our student base. Obviously, it helps with enrollment numbers, but it also lets this particular segment of students know that they can do college. Prior to these workforce classes and doing them the way that we do, a lot of times with action learning and hands-on learning, they would have never dreamed of being in a college classroom. But after these experiences, they know that they can do college. And then the last two points are really go hand in hand. We give practical knowledge to students. It's not that we ignore the theoretical side of things, because we do talk about that, but it's a very small part of what we talk about. Rather, the practical knowledge is what we focus on. And then in doing so, this allows those workforce students the ability to take what is learned in the classroom and immediately apply it to their professional situations.
So why is workforce important? Obviously, there are a number of different reasons why a university would decide to focus on workforce as one of their strategic goals. But here's the thing to consider for each of these types of classes, is that it does allow an employee. Now, that may be an executive. It may be someone that, as we have seen, comes off the, you know, the machine shop or the factory floor and that needs to be upskilled for management purposes. So it allows us to take that theory and then put an emphasis on application. It helps us meet the employer and the employee exactly where things are happening, which is often in their actual workspace. It allows us also to be very much a consultant. In a traditional consulting environment, what you would see is that a consultant would come in, they would provide a set of deliverables, and then they would leave. And then the organization would then have to implement those or build upon what those deliverables were. In this type of environment, we're actually creating a set of training wheels. We're coming in, we're letting them understand what that theory is from a traditional academic standpoint, but we're applying it directly to their business. So the problems and objectives that we are trying to meet, we've agreed upon ahead of time, and we marry the theory with the practical application. So at the end of the course, not only do they have a college credit, but they also are able to implement these things on their own, and we remove those training wheels and bid them a successful farewell.
All right, so obviously you know the difference between traditional students and non-traditional students. And so I just want to emphasize, this slide is to emphasize that there is even a further gap between traditional students and workforce students, because you know, non-traditional students might have had in the back of their mind to always go back to school, right? They were just working toward that. A lot of times these workforce students never really considered going back to college. And so we know that traditional students are those straight out of high school. They have very minimal work experience. They have no major life responsibilities, obviously very young. These workforce students can be from any age and any generation, which creates a very interesting classroom dynamic in some situations. A lot of times our workforce students have been out of high school for more than 10 years. And like I've said before, they've never considered really going back to college. So this is a whole new world for them. They have a ton of extremely valuable work experience. You know, they entered the workforce right out of high school and they've worked their way to where they are. So they might have been in the workforce for 10 years. They might have been in the workforce for 25 years. I had a workforce student who had been in the workforce for 45 years. So there is a big gap between those traditional students that we get and the workforce students. And then obviously our workforce students have a lot of responsibilities outside of their job. They are, of course, trying to get through this, a lot of times, first college experience. And then they've got a spouse. They've got kids. They might be caring for parents. So they have a lot of other responsibilities. So we have to take these things into consideration when we are doing these workforce classes. So this next section is all about the administrative side of workforce teaching and some things that we have to consider in this area. So before we start in this area, I want to emphasize that these are 4-credit college classes. And so we have to adhere to what OSHRE expects for 4-credit classes to have and what HLC expects 4-credit classes to have. So we try to be as flexible as possible. We try to meet these organizations where they are, but we have to work within HLC and OSHRE parameters.
One of the questions that we get are the syllabi. How do we adapt the syllabi to a workforce class? Well, we have SLOs, and we typically teach these classes in a traditional setting, whether it's online or in person. So those SLOs are still something that we have to uphold. We still have certain information and criteria that we have to communicate to these students. They are students. So we want to uphold, as Stephanie said, the OSHRE and the HLC requirements. It's the same syllabus that we would use for a traditional classroom setting for the same course. One of the things to consider is the differences. The differences that might be included are that in a traditional course, I might provide a great deal more detail on the individual competencies, the assessments, the assignments that I would be offering to a student. In this type of a course, what we will find is that we may have to adjust that. So my detail may be a little bit less than it would be in a traditional classroom setting. We might find that we are supporting these competencies through additional real-world activities. We find that our syllabus may need to be flexible in terms of how we approach those SLOs to maintain that accreditation and to maintain that standard. But these are the types of things that we would find that we adjust the syllabus. So it may have less detail on the specific nature of each class setting than a traditional course syllabi would have.
So another consideration is classroom technology. You know, I think in all of our classrooms, we just assume that we're going to use technology. We use learning management systems now. Our students have to log into those learning management systems. They get email through those systems, all of those things. But what we have encountered in the workforce classroom is you can do that for some, but there are others that you can't do, use technology with. We have gone from using LMSs to doing a purely paper-based course. The reason being is because these students don't all have computers at home. And although they are still NSU students and they could come to our campus and use our computer labs and that technology there, a lot of them just are not going to do that. And so we try again to meet them where they are. And so I know that last summer, Tena did a course that was totally paper-based. Everything that she did was on paper, and they handed those papers back to her. It was just like, you know, living in the 1920s or whatever. So you have to be willing and flexible with the classroom technology if you're going to implement workforce classes, because not all of these students are where our traditional students are regarding technology. Yeah, a lot of them have smartphones, but what was interesting and something that we didn't ever think of until we encountered it is, you know, they didn't want to use their smartphones because they had data restrictions on their smartphones, right? And so you don't hear about that a lot in this day and age, but in some segments of the population, that is still a very real thing. And so you just have to consider, how much are they going to be able to use technology? What kind of technology am I going to be able to use in this course? And then what adaptations am I going to need to make because of the restrictions that technology might play in this class?
So how do we assess workforce students? And this is done in a variety of different ways. Some of our workforce students, the goal of their employer is that they pass some type of a certification that could be PMP, SHRM, anything that you can think of course. So that certification is a point of assessment for that particular class. We often have classroom assignments and experiential exercises that mirror some of our more traditional offerings of that particular course. Usually these go hand in hand, and it's a combination of all three of these. But one of the things that we always do is we always have a real world and a hands-on project. Our goal is to create a tandem course where the theory and the application is hand in hand, but it's something that is very specific to their organization. And that is where that real world project comes into play. And that is why these courses and these workplaces find such value in workforce classes, because they've achieve something greater than what they would have achieved from a consultant. It's less expensive, and their employees are walking away with the added benefit of training and education as well.
So some other classroom considerations that we've come across in these workforce classes are FERPA releases. So last summer in particular, there was an organization who wanted to know how their students were doing in the class. They wanted to use the course that we were teaching to gauge possible promotions, you know, who is ready for the next level of supervisor or manager or whatever. And so in order, you know, of course, you have to have releases to be able to speak to people about these things. And so doing FERPA releases is something that you might have to do for a workforce class so that, you know, the organization, you can kind of be a go-between between the organization and the student. And now it's really important that if you're doing these, that the student understands exactly what information you're going to be sharing with their supervisor. And then it's important that the supervisor understand the limits of the information that you can share, right? So it's a two-way street there. Tuition. It seems reasonable that, you know, a student enrolls in college and then they pay the tuition. But workforce classes, in all of the workforce classes that we've done to date, the organization is paying the tuition, and they want to do that in one lump sum payment. And as you all may know, that university systems aren't flexible when it comes to this type of situation. And so trying to figure out, how do we navigate getting a lump sum payment and then distributing it between several students? That has certainly been a consideration, one consideration. Another consideration is that both parties understand how payment is going to be rendered. And we have done this through memorandums of understanding. This has been very successful for us. It provides an itemized statement, if you will, in contractual form to the organization, and it lets them and NSU know exactly what's expected as far as the money goes. And so that is certainly something that I would recommend for workforce classes, is doing those memorandums of understanding. And then the last part is consideration is attendance. You know, so there are limits to how many classes that we can do on site at an organization, but for the one that count toward a degree or a program. And so, but for the ones that we have done at the organizations, attendance, obviously, we want the students to be there. We set that expectation up front. but they're on their work site. And so the likelihood of interruptions is great. And so what do you do in those circumstances? I know that there was a time last fall when I was teaching that a guy went out to answer a phone call. He came back in. You could tell that he was a little bit flustered. So we took a quick break and I said, hey, I'm just going to say Jim. That wasn't his name. Hey, Jim, was there something that happened, you know, with that phone call that we could help you with or address in the class? Is there something, you know, we can do to come alongside you and work that situation out? And so, you know, using those interruptions as opportunities can be done. But flexibility with attendance is going to be very important for workforce students.
One of the things that Stephanie and I never really considered going into a workforce class is that somewhere between week one and week 10 or 12, that any of the number of things could happen. And that would include terminations, layoffs, resignations. Both Stephanie and I have gone through situations where we've had RIFs, layoffs, we've had resignations, we've also had terminations. So the question is, how are these students going to be handled? How are they going to complete the course? Because as you know, if we are doing this on site at a organization, they really do not want someone that they have terminated or laid off to come back in and be able to complete the course. And so as we've navigated those, that would be specific to the university to determine what that protocol looks like. But these are things that we had not considered. In a traditional setting, you know, we might the first week see a few people drop, or we might near the drop date see a few people drop out that are not doing well in the course. But this was not something we had considered, that someone could be terminated, laid off, or resign that was actually doing very well in the course, and they had no mechanism to be able to complete it because that was being offered in person at the organization. So these are just a couple of considerations to keep in mind.
Yeah, that was an interesting time for us, for sure. All right, so modes of delivery for these courses. We have done all three for workforce courses. We have done in-person, we've done online, we've done blended. Like I said, there are some limits to how many classes that we can do at a site for a program. And so once that limit's been reached, we're forced to bring them back either online or blended. One thing that we found is that once you've been in the classroom face-to-face, very hands-on, it's really hard for students to make that full transition to online or even a blended class. So for the online classes, what I have found to help very well is to still have those in-person meetings. If we can have them at the campus, great. Maybe we need to have a Zoom meeting. That's fine too, but they really crave those in-person sessions. And so it's just a making that transition and setting the expectations for those students in those instances is going to be very important.
Some things that are important to keep in mind is that not every student in the workforce classroom has elected to be there. This was not optional for them. Some of them are there because their employer feels like they need additional training. They often will feel like it's punitive if they didn't have a decision in it. This works a lot better for organizations who show this as an investment. This is an honor to be a part of this class. They're investing in them and they see something bright in their future, but this is not always how this turns out to be. So we've had a number of different students, which is different than a traditional setting. Often we don't in a traditional setting have a student walk in and say, I don't wanna be here. I wish I wasn't here and I don't wanna come back, but I'm being forced to do so. You know, it's interesting the first time you hear that. Once you've heard it a couple of more times, you have a bit more of a sense of humor about it and you know how to approach it. But the first time, it's a little strange to hear that because we don't often hear that in a traditional type of classroom. The other thing that is unique to a workforce class is that they see us as facilitators, not instructors or professors. We don't go by Dr. Wooldridge and Dr. Jones. We go by first name. This is meeting them at their place of business in a peer-to-peer facilitation type of role. And we found this to be much more effective. They often have a bit of a trepidation when it comes to higher education. They opted to not continue with higher education if they've started down that path, or they never chose to use higher education and get a degree. So there is a little bit of concern and anxiety with them. them. And part of the way that we can break through that is meeting them as a peer-to-peer and facilitating the class and the problem solving in that way. So this idea that we're problem solving, this idea that we're providing a consultative approach to the classroom in balance to the theory is really important. It provides value to the organization, but ultimately it provides value to these workforce students. For those students who were not happy to attend up front, usually this is the type of thing that makes them come around at the end and say, hey, it was all right. And I take that as a real measure of success, that I don't want to be here to it was all right, ends up being a, you know, kind of a measure of success for myself. Self-evaluation is incredibly important. These people, if they're using this in order to demonstrate to their employer that they have management potential, this self-evaluation, am I going down the right track? Am I ready to take these training wheels off? It is very important to them. So we have to figure out how to balance this facilitation with this problem solving and this bit of affirmation so that they feel comfortable moving on without us later on.
All right, so we've talked about some of this, so I'm just going to very briefly talk about these workforce situations. Having inexperienced students and more experienced students in the same classroom can obviously create some difficulty. So trying to just gauge where your students are, you know, and trying to bridge those gaps is going to be really important. We have found that, you know, sometimes we have put in more contact hours than required for these classes just to bring students up to speed and to prevent the class from falling behind, right? Because we're still trying to meet those SLOs. We are still trying to help them gain the competencies they need to meet those SLOs. And so we don't want the classes to fall behind. And that can happen when you're trying to bridge a gap between a lot of students. And so that's just something, you know, it might take more time. That's not something that you hear a lot in the traditional college classroom. But in this case, it might take more time than you thought it would to make sure they are all on the same level.
So this is a work in progress. This is something that as you go along, you're going to find something that works best for your university or your setting. One of the things that we found is that not every faculty member is a right fit for workforce. It's not a bad thing. It's just some have a greater depth of real world industry experience, and they are able to kind of impart that information in a much more consultative way than someone who is, you know, maybe has less experience. There are some people who do not enjoy this type of approach. There are others that would prefer to be in a traditional classroom environment. Me personally, I love my workforce classes. I walk in. It keeps me sharp when I do consulting because I see everything under the sun, every type of problem, everything from standard operating procedures to quality assurance to communication and delegation to management, all of these things in between that we teach. It allows us to maintain that sharpness. And I walk away from each workforce course that I teach saying, I've also learned something, which I think is a huge benefit to me as well. And the relationships that I've developed, not only from a personal standpoint, but for the university have been something that are very worthwhile. So we think that workforce is incredibly effective, but it is not a one size fits all approach.
Absolutely. And to build and to just kind of tag on to what Tena said, one of the things that is great about workforce is it will help you in your traditional classroom because you are finding these real world situations and things that are happening out there today. And you can bring that back to the traditional classroom, obviously, without names, anonymously. But so it really helps not just keep you sharp, but it really helps bring those valuable case studies, if you will, back to those traditional students. So this next slide we had in here in case we had some time, but I see that we've got about a minute left. And so we're going to go ahead and skip through. We were going to tell you a couple of stories, but we're going to skip through that so that we can answer any questions that are out there. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen. And Tracy, she's been monitoring the chat, but I would like to see. Okay.
So feel free to ask questions, please. Unmute yourself and ask a question, or please type something in the chat. We'd love to hear from you.
First off, we'd like to just thank each of you for attending. This has been a very unique and interesting roller coaster of a ride. And we know that there are a lot of universities that are going down this path now. And we just think that the more that we can build other universities into this model, the more that it helps all of us. More organizations will be receptive to these types of workforce courses.
So I'm looking at the chat. Oh, those are from, okay. Oh, they're from Tracy. Okay. Yes, we are doing the micro credentials. So, so that's another thing. I'm glad you asked, Tracy. One of the things that we are doing is building, using Credly as a source to give micro credentials for these classes. And then hopefully, you know, those students want to build on those by actually going through programs. So
that is correct. Currently, all of our business classes and all of our certificate programs have been submitted and are at some place in that process, but they've all been approved at this point.
Fantastic. I'd love to visit you this sometime to kind of talk to you how you approach these employers, talking about these specific skills that you can teach in their location.
Yeah, reach out to us. We'd love to have coffee. We like coffee and right. All of those things. Yeah, for sure.
Okay. Well, I want to thank everyone for coming today and thank Tena and Stephanie for their great presentation. Please stick around. We've got more sessions to attend. I hope everyone enjoyed this as much as I did. Have a great day. And thank you again, ladies.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.